This is the third lecture in the BS Introductory Electrodynamics lecture series, and we will start with the chapter first, which is on vector analysis. This chapter is an important chapter, and it serves as the tools for the rest of the electrodynamics chapters. So we will start with the vectors analysis. We know that we are having two kind of physical quantities. One we call is scalars and the other is vectors. Physical quantities are those quantities which we can measure, and those physical quantities which can be very perfectly described by their magnitudes only, we call them scalar physical quantities, or we call them scalar. And those quantities which requires, in addition to the magnitude, a direction for their complete specification, we call them as vectors. Now, when it is to scalar, this scalar is just a number. It is a physical quantity, but it is just a number. And when it is vector, then that magnitude or that number is being added with a direction. So the vectors, the scalar quantities, like we are having energy or work, it's a scalar quantity. It doesn't require any direction. We are having distance. Distance is like 2 meter or 10 meter. So it is just a number, doesn't require any direction, while most of the physical quantities that we deal are vectors. Like for the distance, we are having a displacement. Displacement is the distance in a certain direction. And the rest other physical quantities, like we are having velocity, we are having acceleration, we are having force, momentum, linear momentum, and angular momentum. So majority of the physical quantities we are having is vectors. So here we will develop, because we know that the algebra which governs the scalar is an ordinary algebra, in which 2 plus 2 will always be equal to 4. But when we are dealing with the vectors, then for vectors we will have to develop the vector algebra, because in vectors 2 plus 2 can be 4 or can be less than 4. So this algebra is required, and for that we will have to put some rules here. And when I talk of a vector, then it's, for example, I'm having a vector A, then this is vector A, I will put this arrow on it. Now this vector A is having some magnitude A. This magnitude is actually the number, and then it is having a direction which defines it as a vector quantity. When this vector will turn this way, means it changes the direction. So in relation to that one, in comparison to this one, I will write this one is minus a vector. Now the magnitude is the same. The magnitude is the same, but it has changed the direction, because earlier the a unit vector, the direction was this way, and now it is this way. So the direction has changed while the magnitude is the same. So minus a and a will be like this. We write it is a bold face. So it is either your book is writing it as a bold face, while we are writing with an arrow on it, is we cannot write bold face, we can't differentiate here. Now then there will occurs that the addition of vectors, like how we will add these vectors, addition of vectors, how two vectors can be added. Now, in addition of vectors, if we are having a vector A and this vector is being added with a vector B, then the resultant will be another vector, which will be, for example, vector C. And this thing is, for example, if I'm having this is vector A, and this is, let's say this is vector B, and I want to add these two vectors. So there is a way to do this thing. What I will do, I will translate this vector and will put it here, because it makes no difference if you translate one vector, keeping its magnitude, its direction in contact, and then you translate that vector. So it doesn't matter that you either translate this one here and then you add up, or you translate this vector here and you add up, or you translate it here and then you add up, the result will be the same. The only rule we will have to take care that whenever we are adding two vectors, then it will be a head to tail rule. Like this is the head and this is the tail, so it will be head to tail rule. We will place it here, and then from the head of one to the tail of the other, we will have the addition of it. So I can write this one like this, that keeping the same inclination, and this vector is transformed or translated here, then the addition of it will be this vector. Means from the tail of this one to the head of this one, and it will be vector C, and this is vector B. Similarly, I can't move this vector here, and then again this will be the addition of it, just like a parallelogram. So it is the way that we can add up the two vectors. We will have to place them head to tail. Similarly, the other thing that we can do here, even if the vectors are more than this one, then we will have to follow the same procedure. Different inclination, different directions, and then we will add up them like that, and in such a way we will be able to find the resultant of this one. Now if, for example, this is 3 and this is 2, then the result is, let's say, 5 here. But if this is 3 and this is 2, but with a different direction, for example, the result may be less than 5. So this is a weird kind of algebra for the vectors. It is not following the ordinary algebra rules. And then we are having a very important one, is the multiplication of vectors. Multiplication of vectors. Now vectors can be multiplied in 3 different ways. The very first one, if I'm having a vector A, and I told you earlier that this is having a magnitude A in a direction A, and if I multiply it with a number, with a means the numbers means a scalar number, then it is, the direction is the same, but this magnitude is being multiplied. Let's say I multiplied it with 2. So 2a vector, now this 2 is a number, so it will multiply with a number, which is the magnitude here. So it will become 2 times a, and this magnitude will be multiplied while the direction will remain the same. This we call scalar multiplication of, or multiplication of a vector by a constant. Any constant a can be multiplied with a vector. It will only increase the magnitude of it, and the direction will never be changed with such a multiplication. And then there are two very important multiplications, how we will multiply two vectors with each other, like vector A and vector B. Now, if I am having vector A and vector B, then how I will multiply them? Because they are having their respective magnitudes, they will be multiplied just like numbers. But what will be the result of the multiplication of directions? And that is the one thing that I have covered in more details in the conceptual physics video series, the translational and the rotational dynamics, and the link is appearing here, and you can watch those 8 to 9 videos. And in those videos, I have explained the translational and rotational dynamics in detail. So when two vectors are being multiplied, then it is to be seen that how they are interacting with each other, whether their interaction is resulting in the form of translation, or their multiplication is resulting a rotation. So one is the means, one will be the linear dynamics and the other will be the rotational dynamics. So if two vectors are, the result of it is a translational dynamics, like it may go this way or this way, any other way, so it is a translational dynamics, and we will write it as a dot product. And when the result of it is a scalar, so A dot B is equal to the magnitude of A multiplied with the magnitude of B and the cos of the angle between the two vectors. Like I'm having a vector, and the vector is, let's say this is vector A. This is vector A. And let's say this is vector B. Now, whenever I talk of two vectors at some angle to each other, then keep in mind that the angle will always be between the tails of the two vector, not between the tail and the head of the vectors. Like, for example, consider here, like what's the angle between vector A and B here? So it is not this angle, because this angle is between the head and the tail of vectors. The angle will always be between the tails of the vector. So what I will do, I will translate this vector A here, and then this will be the angle between the two. So this is vector A and this is vector B, and now I want to find the effect of one vector along the other vector, means the translational dynamics. So it will be, if I consider A and then how much this B vector is along A, so I will resolve this into components. This is having two components here, and this component means this is angle. Keep in mind another thing here, that this is the base, the angle starts from here and it reaches here. So the point from where the angle is starting is called the base, where it is reaching is called the high part, and the remaining one is the perpendicular. So keep this rule always in mind, and then you will never be mistaken in calculating the perpendicular and the base. The point from which the angle starts is the base, where it reaches is the high part, and the other remaining side is the perpendicular. So now here, if I look at this one, then I can see here that this one is the base. So this is the BX component, and this is the perpendicular, so this is the BY component. And the component which is along A is the BX component. So if I write it is A dot B, then this is actually equal to A times BX. And then what about BX? From here, I know that if I write sine of theta, then sine of theta is the perpendicular divided by the hypotenuse. So it is BY over B, while cos theta is the base divided by the hypotenuse. So it is BX over B. From here I can write that BY is equal to B of sine theta, while BX is equal to B cos of theta. So it means that this is A, means the magnitude of A, and this is B, the magnitude of B, and this is cos of the angle, which is cos theta. Now at this point, let me explain this thing that some student asked that why we use cos theta in the dot product and sine theta in the cross product. So this is not our choice, or mathematics is telling us that this, the A dot B means how much B is along A, means the projection of B is along A. We want to translate it in one direction, and this is equal to this. Similarly, if I want to write B dot A, now how much is A along B? So for this I will put, means I will resolve this into components. And now here, when it is resolved into components, then this is the 90 angle, and we will have the, when I resolve this A into components, then this will be the perpendicular and this will be the base, because it is from here to here. So the base will be here and it will be AX here. Similarly, this will be AY, and we will have B times AX. And B times AX is equal to the magnitude of B, the magnitude of A, and cos of the angle between the two. Now I know that this thing I write in simple, I write the magnitude A, the magnitude B, and cos of the angle between them. Similarly, here I write the magnitude of B and the magnitude of A, and the angle, the cos of the angle between them. So it means that A dot B is equal to B dot A. A dot B is the same as B dot A. And that's why we call it a scalar quantity, because it doesn't matter if you translate one vector along the other, means you find the projection of one along the other, or the other along the one. So it is a commutative property, and the dot product is commutative in nature.